Hey guys, it's Mia, and today I am filming another what I eat in a day and what I do in a day during quarantine. But this edition will have baking bread. And no, it is not ketogenic bread. My entire family is not all ketogenic, so I'm going to be baking sourdough bread because I've fallen in love with fermenting random things. So I have a sourdough starter now. I just started brewing kombucha, so we'll see how that turns out. Crossing my fingers because I'm trying to grow a SCOBY from scratch. I basically just watched YouTube videos and then thought I was an expert. So we're gonna try this and see if it works. But like, I'm not sure if it's actually gonna work. So in 10 days, I'll make another video and I'll follow up to see if my SCOBY actually grew or not. And if it did, then we'll actually get to brew the kombucha with it, hoping for that. But anyways, right now I'm gonna have breakfast and I'm so boring because I eat like the same 3 to 4 meals on rotation for breakfast because I know what I like and so I just eat the same thing over and over again. Usually where it changes is with my dinner. I get crafty with different things, but lunch is usually some kind of salad. And then breakfast is 3 to 4 different things. It's usually either French toast, pancakes. French toast, pancakes, which are keto friendly. If you watched my last video, I showed you how to make my zero net carb French toast. That's what I'm actually making this morning. And then the other things I'll have is like cauliflower oatmeal, which is actually gonna be in the ebook that I'm publishing. So keep an eye out for that because I will be publishing my ebook soon. And then the last thing I usually have is just a yogurt bowl. So I'll take a plain, one of those Too Good yogurts that have, I think, 2 grams of sugar in it. And I'll add a little bit of protein powder into it. Right now, my thing has been the Quest peanut butter protein powder and then a little bit of PB2 and mixing it together. And it's like peanut butter fluff. I will do a yogurt bowl a lot of the time with just fruit on top and maybe some grain-free granola or something. So I'm gonna finish my breakfast here and sit down with you guys and have that. And then I'll take you along with me throughout the day as I'm doing different things. I'm gonna be, like I said, baking bread. I'm finishing this ebook hopefully today. I do have to go to physical therapy at 11 for my knee because I think I mentioned in the last video that I had a knee injury. So I haven't been doing my regular workouts, but I have to go to physical therapy now. So I'm going to go there and then I'll come home and catch up with you guys for lunch. But for now, I'm hungry. So let's make this breakfast. This is going on the stove. I am just cooking it on like a low temperature so it all cooks through on the inside and I don't have to worry about like the outside being burnt because no one likes burnt egg and then the inside being raw. So I have it going on a low heat, but my plan right now is just to chop some fruit to go with it and pull out a new bottle of sugar-free maple syrup because I already finished it, like my last one. And then I'm going to film super quick the new trying of that brand protein cookie butter. I ordered a couple of their products, not sent to me, like I ordered them myself. And so in my next video, I'm gonna review them for you guys, but I'm gonna film that this morning before I eat breakfast while my French toast is cooking. My plan was to try them, post about it, because there's not a lot of reviews like on YouTube for them. I think there's just like one guy who's reviewed them. Also, are you guys like team fruit on your French toast? Or are you team banana? Because I'm team fruit, like berries all the way. I guess I should clarify, that's what I mean by fruit. I'm team berries all the way, but like my mom always gets bananas and pecans or something like that. So which team are you? Let me know. Oh, we'll also know. I just got this Lakanto maple flavored syrup. Here are the macros. It looks like it's gonna be, one net carb a serving, just because it's 6 grams of sugar alcohol, 5 grams of fiber, 12 carbs, and it's made with monk fruit and erythritol extract. I like to just leave it as is sometimes and then it'll be zero net carb, but I like fruit, so I put fruit on mine. It's what you love, boo. This is the finished French toast and I'm going to sit down, watch some YouTube, and enjoy this. Okay guys, so I am back from physical therapy. I did my exercises. Oh, I left my paper in my car. But anyways, I had a sheet of paper that like told me what I did and what I need to do. So I'm gonna do those for the next couple of days. Maybe I will bring you along with them in like another video that I filmed, or maybe I'll put it in here. Let's see how I'm feeling, if it seems fun, if that's what I wanna do. Started the bread process. So I fed my sourdough because you're supposed to feed it before you use it. So it's fed and it's sitting in the oven with the light on just so it can get a little bit bigger, let it rise up and start eating away at it. And I'm auto-leasing my bread dough right now. So this is just some flour and some water mixed together. And I've covered it with a wet towel. And I'm going to leave it for like probably another hour or so because I'm waiting on my sourdough, like I said. I have to let this bread kind of auto-lease. It's how the gluten's going to develop and it's going to get better. So just cover it with a wet towel. Minimum that you usually want to do is 45 minutes. I let mine go longer normally just because I do it right when I prep my sourdough starter. So I prep my sourdough starter, I put it in there, I eat breakfast, and then I take care of my bread like an hour later. So it just has a lot of time to auto-lease. And then once that's done, and remember, don't stress, your sourdough should be a wetter dough. So if it's a little bit liquidy, like it's okay. You just don't want like pancake batter. You want it to hold together and to like hold its shape staying off the side, but you don't want it so dry because it's gonna be hard to ferment the dough when it's so dry. They like a moist environment, the bacteria does. So I'm gonna let that go. My plan right now is to get some work done and drink this Bang energy drink for energy birthday cake bash. No, I know they're not good for you, but sometimes guys, sometimes you just gotta, like I need more energy, but it's fine. So I'm gonna get some work done, sip on this, and then I'm gonna do like a really light workout with maybe doing some more exercises. That's my plan for now. I'm gonna get that done, like I said, back from physical therapy. Time to get on the grind, folks. Let's go. Hey guys, so I am back in the gym today. I say in the gym, but it's literally my workout room in my house. So I think two videos ago, I filmed my workout for you guys, and that was before my knee injury was like worse, I guess I would say. It hurts real, real bad now, so it's pretty hard to do any kind of difficult, high-intensity exercise, so I have to do really slow movements. It takes a long time to work out now, which is frustrating because I can't, like, keep a steady pace. What I'm going to video today is the exercises I'm doing for my knee right now because, like I said earlier, I just went to physical therapy, and I got some exercises that I need to do every day, so I'm going to show you guys those exercises, things that are nice to recover for patella syndrome, which is actually what I have in my right knee right now. My quad off my right side is about 2.5 centimeters smaller than my left one, so it's a little out of balance, and I need to get this leg stronger so that my left one will stop taking over and that my knee can actually strengthen back up so that the tendon here goes straight back instead of kind of going to the side and shifting when I'm doing exercise. So I'm going to show you again, like I said, those exercises that I'm doing, as well as a couple other exercises that I'm just throwing in for a workout purpose. So some arm things that I'm going to be doing today. Hi guys, editing Mia realizing something. So I need to disclaim, I am not a physical therapist. I am not a doctor. So please, these are what I'm doing for my knee injury. This does not mean it's what you should do for your knee injury. I'm not diagnosing anyone with patella syndrome. You need to check with your doctor, with your physician, and figure out what your own problem is. It may be different. It may be patella syndrome. It may not. Just know that I'm not a doctor. So I want to disclaim, anyone who's going to try these exercises, make sure you check it with a doctor beforehand if you do have a knee injury to make sure that's not going to make yours worse. So I am doing 3 sets of 10 RDLs on each leg. I'm really focusing on squeezing the quad, which isn't what I'd normally say. Normally I'd say squeeze your glute. However, I'm trying to balance out my quad, so it's more important that I'm squeezing it and making sure that hip stays down. The next exercise I'm doing is propping that back leg against a block, like a jumping block, or you can use a wall, and make sure you have something under the knee, such as a pillow or a yoga mat, to prevent any kind of additional pressure on it. And I'm just thrusting the pelvic center forward rather than arching my back, just slightly moving that pelvic center forward, and that way you can get a nice stretch all throughout the quad. Now I'm doing a single leg Bulgarian split squat with that injured leg forward, going really, really slow to make sure you're careful with the knee does not go over the toe, and squeeze that quad when you go up. Make sure you're squeezing the quad, not the glute or the hamstrings, so you can focus on that single leg strength. Now I'm doing single leg squats just on that right leg. I'm actually holding a resistance band that I've wrapped around something to help me out a little bit, and I'm just going to 90 degrees to make sure that I'm not over pressuring that knee. This is just a light knee flex, so you see I have that little bit of bend, and then I'm just going to pop and really squeeze that quad to help the muscle grow. And here you can watch me struggle to do some pull-ups. I'm trying to get my pull-ups without any assistance or any help, so I'm just doing a couple here, 2 sets of 3,
full extension, so let those arms fully lock out because I get stuck at the bottom getting back up, so I really got to lock and work on that. And now I'm just doing some cable fly type things with the resistance band to kind of get that pull back and squeeze my shoulder blades together. And now I'm just doing some good morning, so keeping that back neutral, bending it first, and then going into a nice squat, coming back up, and then again, keeping that back neutral and flexing it straight. Here I am doing tricep extensions, and there's two different ways you could do it. You could do it with the resistance band or with the weight. And then I'm just finishing with some round dumbbell raises, so slowly moving that up and squeezing.
Okay, so I just finished my workout, and now I'm going to make some lunch. So again, like I said this morning, I kind of stick to the same things. I like a routine. I like a pattern with my food. It's just easy. So I'm going to make a salad, and I'm going to make one of my favorite salads, which is like a roasted vegetable, roasted chicken thigh salad on some spinach. And so I'm going to show you how I make that in my air fryer. So usually I start with a chicken thigh. I just got these free range chicken thigh fillets. I grabbed a smaller one. It's only 3.3 ounces just because I'm not like super hungry. So I don't need anything with like a lot or any fancy thing. And then I'm just going to crack, you know, the usual salt, pepper. If you're Italian, you know where it's at. Garlic powder on everything. So some garlic powder, and then I'm going to just do a little bit of Italian seasoning. So now that my chicken thigh is done, I'm going to stick that in the air fryer and then prep the vegetables to roast. But you always roast them. Never steam them. That's just terrible. No wonder you hate them if you steam them. I like to just cut them into like quarters or sometimes even a little bit smaller so they're like shaved almost. Because I don't usually put dressing on my salad. Sometimes I'll put a little bit of olive oil, but what I like to use is just like avocado and mash it kind of a bit in my salad so that it coats on my salad. That's what I usually do, but if you like to put a dressing, you know, go for it. Just make sure if you are ketogenic that you check to make sure that it doesn't have enough, like that it doesn't have a lot of sugar in it, because a lot of times dressings will get you by like stacking the sugar content and they're absolutely terrible for you. So try to stick to stuff like ranch, Caesar dressing, but even that, just know you're gonna get like crappy oils if you're buying them from the store. So it's easiest to either just make them yourself, or you can get a good one, like one from Primal Kitchen. Maybe I'll link that below. I'll link that in the description box. One for Primal Kitchen. And you guys can check that out. I'll probably use an affiliate link, just so you know. That just means that you're getting sent there from something that I posted. It helps me out. I wanna disclaim that it does help me out. But you don't have to use that. I'll still love you if you don't use my affiliate link. Probably let that go for like 7 to 10 minutes and then it should be ready. And so while that is going, I'm going to prep the rest of my salad. I wanted to let you guys know, I did eat one smart cake. There was only one left in here, so I had one smart cake and then one square of dark chocolate because I like always need something sweet after I finish my meal. I'm going to show you guys the bread here, the stretch and folding that I'm doing. So the thing with sourdough is that it won't really double in size. It might get a little bit bigger, but it doesn't like double in size as most breads with an active dry yeast would. So sourdough is also a very wet dough. It should be wet. Don't fear that. You'll learn kind of how to deal with that. But this is what the stretch and fold is. It's just pulling the dough, scooping it up, pulling it here, and then slapping it down just so that you can get that gluten developing. And like I said, you're gonna do this 4 times. What I'm gonna do is just one on each side and then cover it with a towel and wait another 30 minutes. Okay, so I just made dinner. I made some roasted acorn squash. I put a little bit of salt, cinnamon, and avocado oil on it. Then I made my favorite, like, roasted chicken drumsticks that I actually learned how to make from my host family in Spain. And then I prepared some green beans with butter, garlic, salt, and garlic powder. So we are gonna have that for dinner, and then dessert, obviously, as always, will follow.
Okay, momentary meal pause to show you what I did with my bread. Basically, I cut it in half to separate it into two loaves, and then I did a pre-shaping. You could see my first one was kind of messy, but I did a pre-shaping where you just pull it, you fold it over the sides, and you roll it up, and I do that and place it into a floured towel cloth, and then this is going to sit in the fridge to ferment overnight. And of course, now we have dessert. So I had a chocolate Quest cookie, as well as this light ice cream that I found from Target brand. I got it because it was cheaper, and it's actually made with good ingredients like erythritol. There is a little bit of sugar in there, so I'm not eating big scoops of this, just a little serving, not even like a full serving from it. But it was pretty tasty, and I had that with peanut butter. Okay, so I preheated my oven to 500 degrees for 45 minutes to get it really hot, and I don't have a Dutch oven or like a pizza stone that I could bake this on, so I just used the heaviest bottom cookie sheets I had. And you can see my bread over here. I was just checking to make sure it's proofed correctly. You should be able to push in, and there should be a little bit of a dent left, but spring back a little. And that's how you know it's well and proofed to go in. Okay, so I had my bread in there for 20 minutes. I put a cookie sheet lined with aluminum and tossed some ice in right when I put them in. So steam should come out and give the bread a nice spring after this first 20 minutes, which it did. So I just set it for 20 more minutes at 450 degrees. The hollow bread tap was a success, folks. It is good to go.